Let's begin the session with a new topic called dimensionless numbers. So what we are going to learn from here before starting, and what kind of questions will you expect from this particular topic? I will discuss that and then I will proceed with the content. First of all, this is a very, very important topic. Now, as you know, this GATE Aerospace from previous exam onwards, they have created a new scheme that you can choose any another options. Okay, apart from GATE Aerospace, you can choose another option. Another option we had is engineering science. Okay. So engineering science consists of fluid mechanics, thermodynamics, structures, and so on. So if you are attempting that fluid mechanics, then these subjects are going to play a very key role. In addition, even in there are some questions where you need to use this concept, dimensionless number. Okay, so I will show in the upcoming chapters that that what kind of questions are possibly asked from this dimensionless and how this is going to be beneficial. Now, as we say dimensionless, that means we already something relate something with some ratios, and how we relate the ratio into the field of aerospace and other relevant mechanical engineering field. So if I consider maybe in terms of heat transfer, maybe in terms of to identify the flow, to identify the force acting on it. So there are lot many ways that we can identify using this dimensionless number. So this is the main. Now coming to the GATE point of view, how it is going to play a very major role. So here nearly about, I think, 2 to 4% of the questions, they come from this particular topic, or I can say relevant concepts are being asked from this particular topic. So you know how much it is important, each and every percentage, each and every marks are equally important to get a good score. So let's begin with just a second. Just a second. So here comes the what is dimensionless number. So as I have shown you this slide where you can see the definitions. So I will not waste much time, but to telling you the the definitions. So let me highlight the key points. Okay. So and as per the competitive exam is concerned, here definition is also not important. But what is important here to identify the key dimensionless parameter. So if any quantity is there, for an example, if I want to define area, how do I define area in terms of the dimensionless quantity? So dimensionless quantity are basically with these are the fundamental dimensionless number, you can say. So length, which is represented as L, mass M, and the time T. So if I have to define with a dimensionless number, what I will do with L square, because I know what is mean by area, length cross breadth. So this unit is meter, this is also in meter, so meter square or the length square, anyways it is a length. Fine. Now if I have to represent something more complicated, let's go for force. What is force? Basically mass into acceleration, isn't it? Now mass I can directly write here M. What is acceleration? How will I write? We know what is a unit, meter per second square. So from there I can write, this is mass M into L T minus 2. So this becomes my dimensionless number for the force. Now there are lot many forces that are acting on an fluid, so that also we will discuss. So based on the scenario, based on the situation, based on the type of the application, you can say, so the force will also vary. There are approximately 6 to 7 different types of forces acting on a fluid. So again, how this those parameters will vary, that also we will look in the upcoming session. Then as I have said, there are of primary and the derivative quantities. So there are lot many different types. Basically there are of 4 derivatives. So basically they start with the fundamental, where we decide length, mass and time. Then comes geometric. Geometric means to define your geometry, especially the area or the volume. Then comes kinematic quantities and the dynamic quantities. Kinematic quantities and the dynamic quantities. So these are the key secondary derivatives. Now you should know this, what are the kinematic quantities and the dynamic quantities, because in your competitive exam they will give you some sets of data, and from there you have to select which among is the most kinematic or the dynamic quantities. So even if you are doing any research or if you are doing any other for your exam or any kind of projects you are doing, so you should know which parameters you are doing, or you are doing analysis, what's the difference between kinematic quantities and the dynamic quantities. You should be very clear with that. Now let's focus with the kinematic one. So what is mean by kinematic? Which represents something related to velocities, acceleration, discharge, and kinematic viscosity falls under the kinematic quantities. Okay, so you should know the sets of kinematic qualities. So as you know, what is velocity, you know its unit. So if you know its unit, it will be very easy for you to find out the dimension for the respective quantities. Discharge, what is discharge? Q, it represents as Q. It is a, can anybody tell what is discharge? Can anybody say what is discharge?
Ma'am, it's volume by time, ma'am. No. Discharge. No, rate of flow of volume.
No.
And discharge goes to area into velocity.
Exactly. Discharge is area cross velocity. Okay? Don't get confused with the mass flow rate. Mass flow rate is the mass with respect to time. Mass of fluid flow with respect to time we call as a mass flow rate. And how this mass flow rate and discharge is different, we know as per the continuity equation is concerned, rho av. Okay, so we know if any section is there, whatever the section, right here the section 1 and section 2, fine. Now here we have the mass flow rate is entering will be equal to the mass flow rate at the exit. So if the density of the fluid is same, that means if I consider it's an incompressible flow. Already Jiniraj sir has completed all the relevant things with respect to incompressible flow. So if the fluid is incompressible, so if I apply in this mass flow rate, what I will get? A1 V1 equals to A2 V2, isn't it? So that means if in this condition, if it is an incompressible flow, the discharge of the fluid is going to be the same. Now, for an example, most of the time you have done the experimentations in your fluid mechanics lab, this orifice meter, venturi meter. So actually, what you are finding there, you are not finding the mass flow rate. You are finding there a discharge, as because you know when the fluid is flowing inside the pipe, whatever the orifice meter or whatever the valve it is flowing, then there is not going to make any changes in the fluid. It's going to be an incompressible flow. So always you write there, you are finding the discharge. Yes.
Ma'am, actually, discharge is what I have seen the definition. It is anything that is flowing with respect to time. So that can be mass flow or volume flow. That's what I know. So that's why I had a doubt, ma'am.
Yes, we can say it is a mass flow only if there is a condition. Only if the flow is, it is incompressible. What you said is right. But there is a condition also, okay? So this is
okay,
the condition,
ma'am.
Right? So you can prove that mathematically also. Right. So these are the very, sensitive thing. So this is where even you are going for any interview. This is the very, sensitive part. You have to focus on this, or you can say key or concepts. Right. Next comes a kinematic. Now, most of the time you get confused with kinematic and dynamic, because viscosity have two forms. One is a dynamic form, one is a kinematic form. You always should remember the formula or the relation between how this kinematic viscosity is related with the dynamic and the density. So basically, if I have to express this a kinematic viscosity, so we can relate that in terms of your dynamic by the density. Now, you might forget what is a unit. So it is very easy to remember the its unit, okay, instead of this dimension. So what is a unit? Meter square per second. Okay, how you can easily remember this? As you know, the acceleration is meter per second square. So instead of that, you are just exchanging the square term. So this is one of the clue that it will help you to remember. So now if you implement the same thing, right? See the dimensions over here. You are getting L square by T. You don't have to solve this complete thing. You can directly use the unit and to find out this dimension, because in competitive exam, time is another a constraint parameter. So you should check that how quickly or fastly you can make the calculations or solve the problem. Let's quickly look to what are the dynamic quantities. Okay, so dynamic quantities, which is as force, weight, density. You can say specific weight, okay, pressure, elastic modulus, anything elastic. It can be Young's modulus, it can be bulk modulus, any kind of modulus of elasticity will falls under this dynamic quantities. Then surface tension, stress, shear stress, work energy, power, torque, momentum, right? So these are the key elements of this dynamic quantities. So let me highlight one of it. Specific weight. Let's go for the specific weight. Now tell me, what is specific weight? What is specific weight? Anyone? We know specific gravity. What is specific weight?
Specific weight is weight per unit volume at standard temperature and pressure.
It's a?
It's weight per unit volume at standard temperature.
It basically is a definition of weight by volume. if I have to say in general words, right? Now, what is density? Density is mass by volume.
Mass by volume.
Fine. So that means if I, with the density, if I multiply the gravity,
then you will get specific
then
weight.
I will get my specific weight. But you should know what's the definition, because in when we are solving the problem, something relevant to dimensions, these are very important. Similarly, one more parameter, specific gravity. What is specific gravity? Density of any fluid with the
density of liquid with respect to density of water.
Water. We set standard as a water. So we know what is our water density as 1000 kg per meter cube. Right? Now if anywhere they have given that the oil specific gravity is 0.8, that means how can you find out the density of a fluid? If they have given the specific gravity of a oil is 0.8, how will you find
out? We multiply the density of water with specific gravity of oil.
Exactly. So you can find the density of a oil is 0.8 into
1000.
So you will get likewise. And this is a very common questions that they ask in GATE. Okay, so they see, first of all, you should understand the strategy of GATE to clear the GATE. Their main motto to make you confused. So what you have to do, you have to be focused with your concept. No, this is the concept, then this will be the answer. So if you see or refer some of the GATE questions, so it will be like very confusing. You will feel like, oh, this can be. So maybe this, maybe that. It should not be like this when you are solving the GATE paper. You should be focused. No, this should be the answer because this is the reason behind it. Okay? So they will always try to confuse you. Right. Now let me quickly move to the next point is a dimensional homogeneity. Now basically what is that, or whatever any equations are there, in take any equations, so they must undergo this dimensional homogeneity. Now what is that mean, dimensional homogeneity? If let's see here, one example has been given here. What is the example? V equals to root over of 2gh. Okay, now if I find the dimensions of this, this is the left hand side and this one is the right hand side. Now if I solve both separately about the dimensions, that what is the dimension for V and what is the dimension for 2gh, both should balance. That means both the side we should have LT minus 1 as well as LT minus 1. Then only it will satisfy the dimensional homogeneity. And using this concept, they can ask you some questions. Now, what kind of questions they can ask? They will give you some equations, maybe something like that. S equals to A B C by X D power 2. Power 1, power 3, something like that. And they have defined what is S, what is A, B, C, X, D. They have defined. Now they will ask what will be the power of this B. What will be the power of this B? Okay. Now what you have to do, then you have to do use this dimensional homogeneity. So you have to consider both the sides, they are dimensionally balanced. So you have to split them in the dimension. So if this is considered MLT, so if it is does not represent with the mass, then keep it 0. Then if it is having some power, if it is 2, equate to here also what is the quantity of m lt put up, then you have to equate. Suppose here we have around 0, here you have something relevant to 3. Let's consider here that power itself is L. So 3L plus 2, and here power is 2L plus 3. Okay, then you will get two equations. This is just a rough equation I'm giving. So you can able to solve 3L plus 2 equals to 1, or you can solve 2 equals to 2L plus 3. So you can find here what will be the value of L, 1 minus of 1 by 3. The power of L will be something like that. So such kind of questions can also be framed from this dimensional homogeneity. Okay, so this play a very important role, but it doesn't mean you can switch all the parameters to other side and keep this one other side. You will get a different result. What you have to do, you cannot shift from the right hand side to the left hand side. You cannot switch. So you have to split each and everything together, get the equation, and you have to equate both the left hand side and the right hand side. Okay, this is one of the key point for about this dimensional homogeneity. Coming to the next, or moving to the next, is methods of dimensional analysis. So you know there are basically of two methods, and these two methods having its all advantages and disadvantages and limitations. So Rayleigh's number you can hardly do if you have four variables, and if you have more than four variables, then you have to switch to Buckingham Pi method. Okay, so again you have to use some concepts about dimensional homogeneity here. So here you should understand the question that which is a dependent and independent variables. So there is a limitations in the Rayleigh's method, so you can hardly do four variables, max to max four variable. Now here it is the most important thing to understand is to identify the dependent and independent variable. Okay, now what do you understand by the dependent and independent variable? What do you understand by the dependent and independent variable? Anyone?
Ma'am, an independent variable means now it's a fundamental quantity and it does not depend on any kind other thing to support it. Dependent
yes.
is it's not a fundamental quantity. So
exactly.
This is what I know.
Yeah, so that means it is completely have a freedom, right? It does not relate with anyone. Okay, variable which is dependent means have some dependency factor. Suppose if I change the value of x, then the value of y will also change. If I change some for an example, if I change the value of range of an aircraft, then my fuel consumption will also vary. So this is called as a dependent variable, right? Okay, and what is the range? Irrespective of anyone, anything, I can vary the range. But whereas the fuel consumption is a dependent variable. Okay, so similarly, such kind of concept, you should know what are the dependent and the independent variable, which variable should, or the function should be kept first, second and third, or the fourth one. Okay, sequentially, you should know them. So here it is very easy to solve a problem through Rayleigh's method. So what you have to do using Rayleigh's method, here comes one small example. Using this example, I will demonstrate. So here they have said that find the expression of power, that is a power is an dependent variables, depends on individual independent variable, that is a head, discharge, and specific weight. Okay. Now I have to find those functions. So these are the functions head, discharge, and specific rate. So whatever, so after getting that independent parameters, we have to write like this. Okay, some constant. Okay, K is some constant, non-dimensional constant. Okay, so first parameter with the power of A, second one with the power B, and the third one with the power C. Now what we are going to do, we know what we have to again subdivide into there what is the dimension. So I know the dimensions of head is L, Q is L cube by T minus 1, then specific weight is M L minus 2 T minus 2. So now I will use the dimensional homogeneity, so both equating left hand side and the right hand side. So I know what is the power dimensions I have written. Okay, now compile it together. Here they have done it together, not done it together. So keep the K aside. Now how many M we have? We have only one M. M power C. Then L. L we have A, then plus 3B, then we have minus 2C. Then T. T we have minus B, minus 2C. And in the left hand side we are having ML 2 T minus 3. Fine. Now I can, that means I can equate in this way, that means M power 1 equals to M power C, that means C equals to 1. Next, L power 2 equals to L, A plus 3B minus 2C. So I am getting here one equation, A plus 3B minus 2C equal to 2. Now previously I found what is my C value, 1. Substitute here the value of C, A plus 3B minus 2 equals to 2. So I will get further A plus 3B equals to 4. As I don't know what is A and B, so I get another equation. Solve the next one. T power minus 3 equals to T power minus B minus 2C. So as a result, minus 3 equals to minus B minus 2C. So you know what is the value of C here? 1. So minus B minus 2, here minus 3. So what you get here? So B equals to, you get 1 again. Right? Now substitute that value over here, you will get the value of A. It means A plus 3 equals to 4, that is A becomes also 1. So that means how you can relate P equals to K, H power 1, Q power 1, and the W power 1. This is how you obtain the power.
And it will given in the question like P is the depend on H, Q and W. It will always
given
in the question.
It will be given. As I've said in the previously also, they might give you this kind of questions like they will give you this equation. Okay? They will give you some equation and they will ask you what should be the dimension of this. They can ask in this way also. That means they have given you P equals to H, Q and Z. Okay. Now they have given you the power of this is 1, this is as 1. Find out the dimension parameter of this. So you know what is P. They will define what is P. P is power. Okay. That means M L my L 2 T minus 3. Next H is the head, that is L. What is Q? Q is the discharge, so which is L 3 T minus 1, and Z, it's unknown. You don't know that. So there are two possible ways. So you can take some value of z as m a l b and t c. So we will combine all together, you will get one equation, right? So if you get that and solve it in the same way, right, you will get to know the power of m of a, l of b and t of c, and you will get the dimensions of those things. Got the point? Could you able to follow? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are.
Okay. So I hope you could follow this. Right.
Yes, ma'am.
So competitive exam, they will always make the things complicated. So this, they will not give in a very easy way. They will switch back and they will give. So you should be ready with any kind of questions they ask. Now next, we will switch to Buckingham Pi theorem. Now here, the main thing is to understand the definition and the process. So I have not seen any paper where they ask to solve using Buckingham Pi theorem. So here what they will say, how the variables are related with each other, and what are the Buckingham parameters, what will be the number of variables, so and so will be asked. Now to understand this thing, let's see what this Buckingham Pi theorem says. So the definition, I think all are well aware. So let me go through the definition here. If there are n numbers of variable, okay, n number in the sense which includes both independent and dependent. Now whereas in the Buckingham Pi theorem, let me tell you, in the question they will not tell you which are the parameters to be dependent and independent. So there are certain rules. Using the rules, you should identify which are going to be the dependent and the independent variables. Okay. Now, if there are n number of variables consist of both the independent and dependent in a physical phenomena, and if these variables contain m fundamental dimension. So they have considered the m as the fundamental dimension, that is MLT, which already we have studied. Then the variables are arranged in n minus m dimensionless term. So here the dimensionless term denoted as a pi. So what should be the quantity of pi will be equals to n minus m. Okay. So that means if there is n is having 5 variable, so what should be the pi term, number of pi terms, what should be the number of pi terms? N minus m. So what is n? 5. What is m? 1 2 3. So m is always 3. So 5 minus 3 equals to 2. So you will have pi 1 and pi 2. 2 pi terms. So this is very important. They ask the question from here most of the time. Now the next type of question they can ask, if they have given 5 different variables. Okay. Let's consider the 5 different variables are x1, x2, x3. x4 and x5. Now how you are going to fix this, how you are going to, which are the dependent and independent variable, how you are going to relate them? So from here you need to identify which is the dependent variable which is depending on other 4 different factors. So you have to write a equation something like this. Okay, something like this. So you should.
And these are dependent variable.
X2, x3, x4. These are the independent variable. We have to identify the independent variable. And x1 is a dependent variable. So x1 depends on so and so independent variables. So this is one of the key thing over here to identify what are the dependent and independent variables. Now this is the way we actually define the pi terms. So as I have said, if the n minus of m, if n is 5 and m is 3, so number of pi terms will be 2, right? That means we have pi 1 and pi 2. How to write this pi 1 and pi 2? So we have to write like this. So pi 1 means what are the independent variable we have. We have to first write with the power of a1, b1 and c1, and which is a depend that your dependent variable we have to write at the last end. Okay, next the pi 2 has to be followed. This dependent parameters, okay, sorry, independent, core independent parameter should be common. The other two will be varying. And what are this x2, x3 and x4? These are the list of x3, x2, x3 and x4, which has to be, that means these are the repeating variables, right? Methods of selecting the repeated variables. So you first choose the first, that means x2 parameter, the x2 parameter first be of geometrical property. It should define the geometrical property. Now you have to look to the parameters, what are the parameters has been given in the geometry. So first choice, first preference will be given to the length. Second, if there is no length, then the diameter, then the height or the head. Gradually it will come. The first and foremost preference should be given to the length, okay, when it comes to geometry. Now x3, x3 defines the flow property. So either the again, when it comes to the flow property, first the priority should be given to the velocity, then acceleration. And the x4, right, the third repeated variable should be of fluid property. Now among this fluid property, again there is a variation. The first and foremost preference should be given to dynamic viscosity, then density, then etc. etc. parameters, specific weight and other parameters will be coming. So the choice of this parameter are to be remembered. Okay, these things should be remembered. I hope simultaneously you are noting down the points. So these points, if you're not noting down, please note it down, because when you're going for the exam, this kind of notes are going to be helpful for the last moment of revision. Okay, so please do note down the points. Now here is some brainstorm for you. Read the question and give me the answer in the chat box. Give me the answer in the chat box. Give me the answer in the chat box. Read the question. All of you must answer it. I record only one answer.
मैम एन प्लस के
एन प्लस के
मैम बिकॉज इन द पाई मेथड वी आर टेकिंग द डायमेंशनल वेरिएबल्स अलोंग विद दैट वी आर टेकिंग द प्राइमरी डायमेंशन सो इट शुड बी एन प्लस के
नो 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 सी रीड द क्वेश्चन. A phenomenon is modeled using n dimensionless number with k primary dimensions. What should be, that means they have asked the number of non-dimensional variables. So from this question you should able to understand that they are asking about Buckingham Pi method. Here the n is the number of variables, okay, and k is the primary dimension, means m is the fundamental dimension, and the number of non-dimensional variables, that means pi. So what is the function of pi? N minus of m, so instead of m they have given k, so n minus k, okay. So as
okay ma'am,
as I have said that in a gate question, and this is one of the gate question, so they will give the question in such a way that which will make you confused. So this is another key parameter to crack any competitive exam, not only gate. If you're preparing for other competitive exam, read the question carefully. This is very important. So the questions are almost been known to you, but without, by just, you just get rush up to answer it. But first you read and understand, then you answer. So as you know, any kind of competitive exam consists of negative marks. So this is the very thing which will make your rank backwards, which will not lead you to score good marks. So you need to avoid this thing. So you need to practice from the scratch, okay. So only after each and every explanation I am giving some kind of MCQ, so you get the clarity and idea. These are the basic questions. This one consists of one mark. Just think, for your wrong, for your like you, as you have made some, you know, careless mistakes, you have lost 1/3 of marks, right? So please be careful while answering it. Now entering to the another very important.
And can we solve one example of Buckingham Pi?
See, most of the time they are asking this question. They don't ask a question from Buckingham Pi theorem. They don't ask. Okay. They don't ask. Okay. They mostly ask a question from the theorem, or maybe they will give you find out this variables using this concept. They will never ask you to solve a problem, never. But they will ask you to solve a problem from this particular topic, similitude, types of similarities. Okay, so I am going to the problematic side right now. Okay. Right now basically here there's nothing to learn something theoretically, so just understand the basics and we will move to the problem. Now basically similitudes are of three types: geometric, kinematic and dynamic. So already I have discussed the dimensionless parameters. What are the factors of geometric, like area, volume, Then kinematic means you're having discharge, acceleration, velocity. And dynamic means you're having energy, power, elasticity, modulus of elasticity, dynamic viscosity, density, weight, so and so. Okay, so these are the things. Using those parameter, how we can use in the realistic field and to solve the problem. So to understand the similitude, what they say here is they find the similarity between the model and the prototype in every respect. And this is a widely used if you're going for any kind of experimentation. Suppose you are designing an aircraft and you want to measure that what should be the wing loading and other parameters in the wind tunnel. So do you think you are going to make a huge big aircraft and will test in a test section? No, right? So you use this similitude concept over there. So what is the concept? You have the similarity between this model and the prototype. Now before moving into more depth, so you should know what is the difference between model and the prototype. Okay, so what do we define by the model and the prototype? Okay, model means actually you are making a scaled one, okay, from the actual product. Maybe you are designing a fighter F-16 aircraft and you are scaling down to around maybe of 20. Okay, so that means you are scaling down, that means that becomes the model. The actual one becomes the prototype. Okay, so this is the most confusing thing, so you should remember this. Prototype is the actual one, model is the scaled one which you are going to test. And in the questions which you will get in the gate or something, they will mention this this word, model and the prototype. So you should able to identify the model and the prototype, and that plays a very important role to identify. Okay, identification by reading the question and identifying the value which they have given is for model or for the prototype. Because when you will solve, you will understand why I'm telling so. Okay, so they will not give you in a direct way. So you should understand the question very carefully. So this kind of similitudes can be done in three forms: geometric, where it relates with this length, area, volume; kinematic, I think I've given the kinematic, yes, kinematic, where it relates with the acceleration and velocity. Okay, and next we have dynamic similarity. Dynamic relates with the types of forces, weight, you have dynamic viscosity and etc. Okay, now let's see how we utilize those things. Before utilizing this means that we are both the similarity in forces. Dynamic means similarity in the forces between the model and the prototype. Kinematic means the similarity in motion. Okay, similarity in motion both in model and the prototype. And as I've said, the geometrical one, that means similarity in their scaled products. If the respective similarity in properties, okay, everything is same. So that one we call as a geometrical similarity, maybe in length, area, volume. Fine. Now here comes another very, 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 very important topic: the types of forces acting on a moving fluid. So basically there are of six forces that are acting, and how you can use these concepts in a dimensionless number, so it is a very important part. So before that, quickly write down what are the different dimensionless numbers, different forces acting, right, one by one. Once you have completed, just let me know. Inertia force, viscous force, gravity force, pressure force, surface tension force, elastic force. Okay, so basically there are of 6 types. Now let's start one by one. Now what is inertia force? So as you know by the term inertia, that means it is something with mass into acceleration. Okay, mass, so Fi, mass into acceleration. Now how can I write this acceleration? Can I write in a dimensionless term like L by T minus, 2? No need to write minus 2. L by T square. How can I write mass? Mass can I write density into volume. So further can I write like this, rho into L power cube. Now if I combine these two together over here, rho L cube into L by T square. Now let me further simplify this rho. Let me take L square by T square into L square. I have splitted this cube. Okay, that is in terms of L square into L. So L and L becomes L square here. Now what is rho L by T whole square into L square? What is L by T? What is M by S, meter per second? Velocity?
Speed or velocity?
Yes. So I will write rho V square L square. That is my inertia force. Because why I have split it down this thing, because there are some questions, so you need to use this, you know, implementations, and you can able to find out what actually is the inertia force. So that's why I have differentiated this over here. All right. So, I hope it is clear, this explanation. If you want me to repeat, I can repeat.
No, ma'am, it's clear.
Clear. So, let me give you the glance, what I have done. So, first, I know what is inertia force, mass into acceleration. Now, acceleration I have classified, or I can split it into dimensional form, L by T square. Mass also I have done, rho into V. Okay. Now, I will keep the rho as it is, because I need, because this is a very significant parameter, I am not changing that until required. So, I will keep the rho as it is. I will only change the volume. So, volume I have written as L cube. Now, I have compiled these two together, simplified, I have converted this term into velocity, and I obtained this parameter. Fine. Next comes the viscous force. Now, what is the main important thing in the viscous force? Is a Newtonian law of viscosity. And talking about what is a Newtonian law of viscosity is the equation that is shear stress is equals to nu du by dy. This is the shear stress. But here they have asked about the viscous force. Now, how can I convert this into viscous force? So, can I write F of V by area? Can I write equals to mu du by dy. Fine. Now, as here we are only dealing with the viscous force, V of F, that is a viscous force, I will take this term over there, mu area, here we have du by dy. Now, let's convert these terms into dimensionless numbers, like in terms of the fundamental dimensions. How will you convert? The basic fundamental dimensions, if you have to convert.
I'm first convert A as square.
Okay. So first we will convert, keep the mu as it is. Okay. I will keep the mu as it is. And here we will keep the, just a second. I will keep this du as v, mu v. What is the a? L square by L. Can I write L square by L? So this L and this L will get cancelled off. So we will get mu v L for a viscous force. So if they're in any question, they're asking something relevant to viscous force. So you have to use this formula, mu VL. Okay. So that time don't think that where is du. Okay. So for the dimensionless problems, so this kind of implementation will be used. Next, we will have, I will change the color, is a gravity force. Gravity force. Now same kind of implementations will be applied over here. Gravity force. Mg.
Mg.
Mg. Okay. So what, how I can convert this? Any idea? Fg equals to m into g. So mass, let's convert rho into V, that means rho into L cube. So simply it will can be written rho G L cube. G, don't need to change the G. Okay.
G, because G has fixed value, no? 9.8.
Yeah. Yes. So keep it. Next, move to pressure force. Pressure force, what do you understand with the name of pressure force? How do we expand this? So pressure into area, again very simple, pressure, we will not change the pressure anything with this pressure, P into L square will give you the pressure force. Right?
Then why we did not change pressure?
See, these are the variables, because in the problem, right? So the pressure will be given or some other parameters will be given. But they will give you only the dimensions of length which will be varying. So if you use these functions which will make you your formula very effective. Or we will see some of the dimensionless terms where you need this pressure, maybe the Weber's number, Euler's number, you have heard about those things, right? So how those are derived, how those formulas you can, you know, implement. So if you change the dimensions, the things will become complicated. If required, you can change, but these are the standard form. You're getting the point?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So similarly, surface tension. Okay, surface tension, what will you use? Surface tension, tell me.
Surface tension.
Yeah. surface tension instead of force. What is surface tension unit? Newton per meter.
Yes.
So from there, what you can find? Surface tension force means surface tension into some distance or length. So you can directly write sigma into L. Right? Next, elastic force. Irrespective of what bulk modulus or elasticity or whatever it is. How do we define? What is our form, your unit? Newton per meter square. So if I using this elastic force, that means K into L square. What is K? K is any kind of elastic modulus. Elastic modulus. Right?
Yeah.
Follow? Right. Alright then. So I think we will continue the class tomorrow. So tomorrow you tell me that when should we conduct the class? What time?